Texas Lutheran University.
Confronting Race, History, and Symbols of Exclusion, organized to provide an academic context for meaningful conversations that incorporate history as a central lens for examining recent events in our country. The colloquium was organized by our VPAA, Debbie Cottrell, Amelia Coford, Elizabeth MacArthur, and myself, with generous funding support from the Brown Cultural Enrichment. Before introducing today's speaker, I'd just like to take this opportunity to invite all of you to visit our interactive exhibit in Bloomberg Library, which kicked off our colloquium last week. The exhibit, entitled Confederate Battle Flag, the Legacy of a Racist Symbol, will be open until the end of February. In addition, Dr. Cottrell will be leading an activity module this spring as part of the colloquium, entitled The Past Meets Present, Flags, Statues, and Buildings. And finally, our colloquium will end in February with a keynote address by Brian Stevenson of the Equal Justice Initiative, entitled American Injustice, Mercy, Humanity, and Making a Difference. And now for today's speaker, Dr. Leonard Moore is a professor of history and a senior associate vice president at the University of Texas at Austin. He teaches courses on Black politics, and he directs study abroad programs in Beijing and Cape Town. He is a native of Cleveland, Ohio, and he earned his BA at Jackson State University, a historically Black college, and his PhD at the Ohio State University. He is married with 3 children. The title of his presentation is The Worldwide Leader, What ESPN Teaches Us About Race in the 21st Century. So let's please welcome Dr. Moore.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon. I almost got lost. I thought Seguin was up near Waco. And I live in Round Rock near IKEA. So the plan was I was going to leave campus, go home, and meet my son at home. And then I was going to drive up. But when I looked at the map last night, I said, I got to go the other way. All right? But thank you. So it's good to be here. So I got several ground rules. So at UT, I teach classes with about 500, 600 students. All right? I like teaching large classes. We have some ground rules. Number one, I am not politically correct. Number two, you can't get mad at anything I say. All right? Okay? All right? And three, we're gonna have fun, all right? I think discomfort is the fertilizer for growth. And so interesting that this talk was scheduled today. We saw what happened over the weekend, right? Group of football players at University of Missouri came together, and they told the administration that, you know, we're going on strike. We're essentially not going to play until the president was fired. Now, what's interesting about the story is that a grad student has started the protests last week, like either on Tuesday or Wednesday, and what they said was that there were no reporters around. Nobody came to check on this grad student who has started a hunger strike. But less than 30 hours after the Black members of the football team say they aren't going to play, the president resigned, all right? And in some ways, it just shows you just sort of the power that African-American athletes have, particularly at the collegiate level, all right? But on the flip side, I think what those young men in Missouri were dealing with, I think they were in many ways expressing the frustration that they deal with, you know, being a gladiator at a predominantly white institution, okay? So got my PhD at Ohio State. While I was there for 4 years, I worked with football and basketball players, primarily some women on the track team, some women on the basketball team, tutoring. 9 years at LSU, and I've spent 9 years at Texas. So I have seen how, in many ways, the loneliness and the marginalization of, in many ways, the Black athlete, right? Everybody wants to be an athlete, but nobody wants, in many ways, to walk in their shoes. I am very critical of ESPN. I think ESPN puts this image out that the only thing Black people can do is play a sport. I think ESPN has 6 stations. Can y'all name all the ESPN stations? Two. You.
Three.
Deportes. Deportes for the Latino brothers, all right? Right? Right?
ESPN News.
ESPN News and ESPN Classic, right? And if you watch ESPN, the one thing you got to notice is that they show the same black athletes over and over and over. It's the same 12, right? In basketball, it's LeBron, it's Durant, it's Stephen Curry, and sometimes James Harden, all right? In football, who is it typically in football? Dez Bryant, Marshawn Lynch, Adrian Peterson, but you get this image that there are tons of black people playing professional sports. Whenever I go to my kids' school, I ask them, what percentage of America is black? 80%? 60%? And they're surprised when I tell them 13%. But the image you get, if you look at the image of African-American males, particularly in athletics, is that there are a whole bunch of black people playing sports. And I think right now, today, you have about 1,150 black males who make a living as a professional athlete. About 1,150, all right? And so my critique of ESPN is that they promote the black athlete, but what it does for us, it in many ways has created a culture of anti-intellectualism, I would say, in the black community. I do a lot of consulting with high-profile athletic teams, college teams. I was at one school about a year and a half ago, and I asked the guys they were majoring in, and a lot of them had the same major, and one guy, he whispered, "Mechanical engineering." I said, "Why don't you want anybody to know?" He said, because he didn't want, he said, "Please don't tell anybody." He didn't want anybody to know how smart he was. He got a 31 on the ACT, but felt that in many ways he had to limit his intelligence, right, to be a part of the group, all right? So what I want to talk about is my experience for the last 18 years cussing coaches out. I said I'm not politically correct, I told y'all that, all right? And just in many ways trying to, I'm not going to cuss in here, but trying to be an advocate for student athletes, right? And I just want to give you a glimpse into the world of the $1 million or $1 billion industry that is built off the backs of young African-American males. How many of y'all saw the Texas game on Saturday? And what was the ultimate irony about the Texas game in light of this discussion about race in America? Anybody?
Quarterbacks are black.
Okay, but what else, okay? Did you see the uniforms Texas had on Saturday? What was interesting about the uniforms they had on Saturday?
28, or they were honoring.
It was a throwback uniform. Who were they honoring?
The All-American guy.
What year?
I think 1969.
1969. So this is interesting, right?
The last non-black camp trip team.
Right, the last non-black. So you have 80% a team full of black players now wearing jerseys from the 1969 team when there were no blacks allowed to play. So I said, well, if we really want to honor the 1969 team, why don't all the white guys play this game and the black guys just sit down? All right? Okay? All right? And Charlie Strong got to sit down, too, and let the white assistant coach take over if we really want to recreate that period. All right? And so when we talk about this overrepresentation of black male athletes, on one end, they're celebrated. But on the other hand, black athletes are also criminalized. Have you heard some of the way reporters are talking about Greg Hardy now? For the Cowboys, they call him an animal. All the adjectives I've heard him describe, they said he's less than human. And nobody in any way is defending a domestic abuser, but just the way they are talking about him is as if he is something other than human. If you watch ESPN on a weekly basis, you'll see at the bottom of the screen, some black athlete got arrested at a university, right? Breaking in, assault, and things of that nature. And what we try to tell these college athletic programs, because they want to win so bad, is that you all are not structured to deal with some of the issues black males bring to campus, right? At LSU, a lot of brothers on the football team carry guns. Now you're like, man, you at LSU, man, what you need a gun for? You know why? He said, Doc, I carry one at home. I'm going to carry it here. And it was often carried for protection. So you got this criminalization that goes on of black athletes that I think ESPN in many ways supports. And so what I've seen over the last 22 years is universities not concerned about the intellectual growth of athletes, not concerned whatsoever about their international growth. And I don't know how it is here, but at most of these big colleges now, the athletes are expected to be on campus 12 months out of the year. That is sort of the expectation, right? That you will be here in June, July, and August working out. So they can't do study abroad, can't get really an internship outside of Austin. And it just goes to feed this mentality that you are to eat, sleep, drink your sport. So when I got to Ohio State as a grad student, I started tutoring in the athletic department just as a way to make money. And I think back in like 1997, they were paying like $10 an hour, all right? And me and a friend, we found a way to kind of rig the system. So instead of me tutoring one guy one-on-one for 1 hour, I would get like six guys together, do a group tutoring session, and charge them like, I'm like, well, that's six guys time an hour, so that's 6 hours worth of work, all right? And it made, I got through grad school off that salary. But what I noticed that what I saw on Saturday afternoon with these young men and women playing basketball and football was not what I dealt with Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night. Isolated, marginalized, didn't feel like they were part of the overall student body. Academic opportunities were limited. And here's how you get clustering at a large university. What's your major?
Education.
What's your major?
Sociology.
What's your major?
Biochemistry.
Biochemistry. Education. What would be your major if you couldn't take any class after 1 o'clock?
Sociology.
Sociology, okay, all right, okay, all right. So the range of majors, guess what happens? It shrinks. Because at some point, if you chemistry, sociology, whatever, you gotta take classes in the afternoon. So what happens, some academic departments specifically put classes in the afternoon so black athletes cannot take their classes. They feel like you have too many black students in a class, they feel it takes away from the rigor of the program. I'm like, what's the quota? 1, 2, 5, 8? How, y'all can laugh at that, all right? Y'all a tough crowd, but that's all right. Y'all not used to this? Huh? She's looking at me like I'm crazy. Like, what is he up there talking about? All right, so let's move on. So anyway, so when I got my PhD at Ohio State, I knew I wanted to work and be an advocate for student athletes, all right? And so it came down to a job at LSU, University of Cincinnati, Clark Atlanta, and also University of Washington and UC San Diego. And I flew to Baton Rouge on the MLK holiday. I'm from Cleveland, Ohio. It was 15 degrees when I got on the plane in Cleveland. It was 75 when I got off in Baton Rouge. All right, so I said, we can close this deal now, all right? But when I got to LSU, it was literally a plantation culture. The young men weren't going to class. They weren't graduating. A ton of off-the-field problems. It was an outlaw culture. But guess what? As long as they won football games, nobody cared. And I remember being a young assistant professor at 27 years of age, just turned 27, meeting with the president, the provost, and the athletic director, and letting them know that things were about to change, all right? And what it amounted to was that nobody had told these young men on the football team that football is an intellectual enterprise. Who plays football in here? Anybody on the team in here? What's your favorite play in the playbook? What's your name?
Roger.
What position you play?
Defensive end.
Watch this. What's your favorite play in the playbook? Any stunt? What's that? I don't know what that means.
Twister.
What is the? Was y'all 3-4 or 4-3?
4-3.
What is the? What are two D tackles doing that play?
They twist. So it's like the ends are designed to come inside and make the sack.
Okay. What are the linebackers doing that play?
Yeah.
What do they do?
Gap.
I don't know what gap means. Gap control. What does that mean? What's A gap, B gap?
What split and the lineman line up.
You said the split and the line. I don't know what that means, all right? All right, what are the DBs doing that play?
They drop any coverage.
What kind of coverage?
I don't know the coverage.
Okay, who plays offense in here? What position?
Line.
What's your favorite play in the playbook?
55.
55, what's that?
It's an outside zone play.
What's that mean?
Sorry.
What is the tight end doing that play? Okay, oh, he's not. What does the X do on that play?
They're blocking.
What does the Y do on that play? Now, what can you call out of 55 audible? Give me an audible out of that.
I don't think it's an audible out of
You just, it's 55 no matter what it is, huh? But my point is, when you talk to football players, they don't realize how intellectual they are. What's your name again, man? The language Broderick was using, A gap, B gap, stunt, twist, cross his face, all that stuff, right? We don't know that. And you're making all those split decisions in how many seconds?
0.5
seconds. So nobody had ever told these young men at LSU that they were intellectuals. But you just got to transfer it to the classroom, right? So they thought, even now, black people believe that we were just born gifted athletically. As if we have like different muscles and extra bones and all that kind of stuff, right? Why do you think that belief is so ingrained in America that black people are just gifted athletically? White things, anybody, why? What'd you say? We believe that, right? But don't we practice though?
We don't want to think you just worked harder.
Right, we don't want to think you were. I was at my daughter's AAU basketball tournament yesterday, and there were some phenomenal young women playing. And I asked one of the dads, I said, man, your daughter is great for a fifth grader. I said, how often do y'all practice? He said, 3 nights a week, the whole year. He drives from Killeen, Texas to Austin 3 nights a week to take his daughter to basketball practice. And I'm wondering if that same energy and time was put into her intellectual development, what kind of opportunities would she have academically, okay? So at LSU, a lot of our work was rewarded, and it was funny because a lot of folk thought I was gonna get fired. Said, Dr. Moore, you better leave that alone. They gonna fire you. But in my mind, I couldn't sit back and watch these modern day gladiators just make money for the university. And what we have found is that the most useless person on a college campus is the former athlete. Ricky Williams came back to school 2 years ago. He was in my class. He came back, and I saw him one day in the back of the class. I said, man, you look like Ricky Williams. He said, I am, all right? And I said, man, what brought you back to school? He said, Dr. Moore. He said, man, I was in Australia, and I liked it a lot. I wanted to buy some property. He said, but first he had to become a citizen of Australia to buy property. Thank you, man. And he said that when he went to become a citizen, he had to check off a skill, because, you know, to get to become a citizen, you gotta be bringing a skill into the country. And he said, Dr. Moore had about 80 occupations, and that's when he said he realized that he was completely useless. Didn't have a skill other than playing football. In many ways, that's what brought him back to campus. And he said, Dr. Moore, you are the first person who's ever told me that I'm smart. And so dealing with all this at LSU, and it was bizarre and it was crazy, it's the SEC, it's the wild, wild west, I had young men on the football team who wanted to fight me because I believed that they could be a good student. One student of mine, he played for the New York Giants for a couple years. He was a junior, he came to take an exam in my class, and he came to the door like that, there was a window, and he called me outside. I said, man, come take the exam. He said, Dr. Moore, I've never taken a test before. I said, what do you mean? He said, I've never taken a test. I said, but didn't you go to that private high school in New Orleans? He said, Dr. Moore, they came and picked me up from home every day at 3 o'clock, took him to football practice, brought him back home. He didn't have to go to school. Unbelievable. When you hear these stories, there was a young man at UT. He cussed me out in class. And if I mention his name, you all would know him, all right? But his teammates said, Dr. Moore, you can't get mad at him. This is the only class he goes to. All right? So I leave LSU in 2007. I'm recruited to come to Texas, all right? And that's the year where he had a lot of young men on the Longhorns football team getting arrested. I was like, okay, we're going to deal with this. So my first day on campus, I go to the football facility, and I say, put all the brothers in my class. And one guy said, man, you don't want to do that. I said, yes, I do, all right? Because I realized that in order to change the culture, you had to start with the superstars first and work your way down, all right? And similarly, we're dealing with young men who were gifted intellectually, right? But never challenged to do more than the bare minimum in school. So what we created up there, we think we're seeing the results of it now over the last 6-7 years, was just a culture where telling young men and young women on the basketball team that you are more than just an athlete. But here's what we find. Anybody here study identity formation at all? Anybody in psychology in here study identity? That the athletic identity for high-profile athletes is so high that they can't imagine themselves doing anything else. I spoke with the NFLPA, NFL Player Association, a couple years ago, about 100 former and current NFL guys in the room, and I said, and all of them appeared to be emotionally broken. And I said, how come you all didn't take advantage of those NFL programs at the Wharton School, all these programs they have for NFL players in the offseason? One guy said, Dr. Moore, as an NFL player, if you start taking advantage of those offseason programs, you have psychologically told yourself that your football career is over. And he said, so a lot of us don't want to deal in many ways with that reality. So the athletic identity, very, very high, but the academic identity, very, very low. Now, here's what I don't like about the system and the way it operates. How many of y'all watch college football? How many of y'all watch Alabama LSU? How many of y'all knew the week before, you whatever you were doing, you were going to watch Alabama LSU, all right? I told my wife beginning of the week, I said, Clemson and Florida State play at 3 o'clock, 2:30. LSU and Alabama play at 7. So I'm off limits from about 2:30 on, all right? And I may watch the late game, USC and Arizona are playing. But anyway, isn't it amazing how we structure our life, particularly here in Texas around college football? But the young men don't get paid. Coaches get astronomical sums of money. But why do we have this view as outsiders that college athletes have it made? One of the big tensions at UT's campus right now is the black students and the black student athletes. The black students think the black student athletes have it made, that they get treated like kings and queens, and the black student athletes feel that the regular black students don't understand their life. So I have a student athlete get up in front of class and describe their schedule. A football player say, I was up at 5 a.m., I had to work out from 5:30 to 7, I had class from 8 to about 11:30, I had to go for treatment at 12:30, I had to be on the field to practice at 2. And then when practice is over, after I eat dinner, take a shower, it's 7:30, then I got study hall for 2.5 hours. And the room goes quiet. And the one thing we tell student athletes is that it is not a privilege for you to play football at Texas or LSU, right? You heard that? How student athletes are told it's a privilege? That's like, what's your name?
Judy.
That's like Judy, me inviting you to my house for dinner like 50 times, and you finally come. And then when you come, I say, Judy, you know it's a privilege for you to eat here. You're like, man, you invited me, all right? But what athletes are told is that it's a privilege for you to come. And how is it a privilege when we started recruiting these young men and women when they were 14 and 15? And we complain about the entitlement aspect. Football players at Texas, on their recruiting visit, do you know where they stay? Not at the JW, not at the Hilton, not at the AT&T Conference Center on campus. They stay at the Four Seasons. And you can just walk through the Four Seasons and tell it's expensive, all right? So the question is, how do we manage this going forward? Because when I was at my daughter's AAU tournament yesterday, got all these black kids, and their whole dream is to go pro. And what makes it worse sometimes is that the parents oftentimes, right, are more caught up in the hype than the child. One of my students at LSU, Marquise Hill, played for the Patriots for a couple years. He said, Dr. Moore, I hate football. I said, why don't you quit? He said, I can't. He said, my family's counting on me. So what happens, that a lot of these young men and women sort of become their parents' 401k plan, right? We put all this into our son or daughter to make it big. But just this internal trauma and these internal conflicts they deal with, that makes it troubling. All right, so 5 recommendations for you. How many sports fans are here? How many binos athletes in here? Y'all know athletes? Okay. 5 recommendations. Number one, if you come into contact with an athlete, ask him about school first. My wife's cousin played middle linebacker at USC, got a degree in engineering. He played with Reggie Bush and Matt Leinart. Went to a family reunion a couple years before he graduated. I said, I'm going to just stand by Champ to see how many of his relatives ask him about school. And these are educated black folks from Los Angeles. Nobody asked him about how he's doing academically. such that so that when he got his degree in engineering, although he was successful professionally, he still felt like a failure. Good friend of mine teaches at Ohio State, Professor James Moore. He said when he stopped playing college football and realized he wasn't going to NFL, he said he couldn't watch an NFL game, he couldn't watch a football game for 12 years. Although he's a distinguished professor, endowed chair and all that, he said it is still hard for him to watch a game because in the back of his mind, guess what? He feels he should be there. Here is where it starts. It starts at church typically, right? When little Johnny scores 4 touchdowns in the Pee Wee game at second grade, and the pastor says, little Johnny, come on down here. You're going to be in the NFL one day, and you're going to buy us a church, and you're going to buy mama a house, all right? But that is where it starts. And with my own son now, who's in the 4th grade, I mean, these people in Round Rock are flat out crazy. I mean, I thought black folk were overinvested in sports. No. Go to Round Rock, go to Plano, go to McKinney, all right? Go to the Woodlands, go to Lake Travis, all right? And they put money into it, all right? So a young man, a coach in the area called me. He said, are you Leonard's dad? I said, yeah. He said, man, your son is the best 4th grader around. I'm like, in math? He said, no, in football and basketball. Can I train him? I said, man, he's in the 4th grade. All right? Number two, second thing I need you to do. Second thing I would ask you to do. Let me pull it out. Is this okay? This good? Is it practical? Maybe. All right. Number two, engage them intellectually. Engage them intellectually. I told the guys at Texas, if I was the head football coach, man, we'd be reading books coming out the tunnel, something crazy like that. But we don't engage, right? And we wouldn't have the names on the back of our jerseys. We would have our majors on the back of our jerseys. That's how you begin to change the culture. But we don't engage student athletes intellectually. And the same thing I see with black football players and basketball players, I see with white baseball players. Y'all got to see that here too? All right, they just different, aren't they? Y'all laughing, okay, they are, all right, all right? But we don't engage them intellectually. The conversation is all about the sport and the highlighting. You can read that in the paper. Engage, what's your favorite class? Who's your favorite professor? What do you want to do when this is over? Had one young man came to my office, burst out in tears when I was at LSU. He said, Dr. Moore, I'm about to graduate. And I said, why are you crying? You know what he said? He said, I have nowhere to go and I have no skill. He said, I've been playing football since I was 6 and now it's over. And ironically, I had a black swimmer have that conversation with me a couple years ago, graduated. And I said, how are you doing? She said, Dr. Moore, I'm struggling. I said, why? She said, because my whole life, I'm used to being around 40 other girls. She said, I don't know how to make friends. I miss swimming. And she said, I felt like a part of me has died. And the phrase we use is called identity foreclosure. Is that when everything you spent your whole life to do is done at 22, 23, 24, and now it's over, identity foreclosure takes place. All right, number three. Help them develop professionally. One of the challenges I'm having now as I go across the country is trying to get coaches to understand that if your student athletes don't study abroad, they don't do internships in the summer, what are their job prospects when they graduate? But how many of y'all have realized that we have created a culture of coaching that is dysfunctional? I did a training with some coaches from across Texas, mostly these wealthy suburban areas. And I said, how many of you all cuss at your student athletes? All the hands went up. I said, what if the principal cussed at you? How would you like it? And I said, what made you all think that cursing was a motivational tool or technique? But our coaches need training because they don't know. And when you ask most coaches how their kids are doing academically, particularly black kids academically, here's what they say. They don't say, well, the average GPA is 3-4. Here's what they typically say. They said this up. Anybody from McKinney in here? Anybody from McKinney in here? Am I going to admit it after the swing pool incident? All right? But coaches, when it comes to black athletes, they typically think in terms of eligibility and ineligibility. But I'm talking about academic excellence, not if somebody's eligible or not. But we have done a horrible job dealing with coaches. And the one thing we got to watch out for is in these female sports, some of these coaches are flat out crazy and terroristic. Some of the things female coaches have told females, it would bring tears to your eyes. But I think they'd get away with it because the sport is under the radar. And I think female coaches do things to female athletes that a male coach would never even attempt to do with the male athlete. And number four, understand, help them understand that the cheering stops at some point. A couple years ago, a couple young men graduated from Ohio State. They played on the football team. They graduated in December 2013. They went to the spring game April 2014. They just graduated. They showed up at the spring game. They were told they couldn't get in because they didn't have a ticket. They said, we just played on the team in the fall. So they convinced the woman to let them in. And then when she let them in, she said, well, can I take a picture with y'all? And they said, What are our names? She said, I don't know. I just know y'all football players. So on one hand, they can't get into the game because they don't have a ticket, although they were played in the fall. And on the other hand, once she lets them in, she wants to treat them like a celebrity, although she doesn't know who they are. I was on a plane once with T. Martin, who played quarterback at the University of Tennessee. He got a ring at Tennessee. Peyton Manning didn't, all right? So when they named the street after Peyton Manning, who didn't win a ring there, they had to name something after T. Martin, who was the black quarterback who got a ring. So we were on a plane one time after they won the national championship. We were both flying to New Orleans. And so he was getting off the plane. People recognized him, signing autographs. And next thing I know, guess what I was doing? I was signing autographs too, all right? I'm Leonard Moore, all right? All right? All right? But we have to hold our universities more accountable how they deal with black athletes, all right? When I go across the country, I challenge athletic directors and head coaches. I grew up in Cleveland. I told people in Texas, I didn't grow up in a culture where you put head coaches on a pedestal. I mean, some of the stuff I see in Texas is completely mind-boggling. And just challenging coaches to do a little bit more, but maybe just the pressure to win is just so great that they don't know how to do more, all right? So the next time you watch ESPN, I want you all just to look at the imagery. Let me hit you with this. Have you ever seen the way that black athletes are described during a game? If you were to turn black in the screen and just listen to the announcers, right? Animal, a freak, right? What they call Marshawn Lynch, beast mode, all right? Got all these animalistic tendencies, right? But typically white players are described in vastly different terms, more intellectual, right? What'd he say? Intelligent. One player said, what'd he say?
Sneaky speaky.
Somebody else said that a CEO in the field. And one announcer said, well, this guy may not have all the physical intelligence, may have all the physical tools, but he could play with me any day. Fundamentally sound, right? And so white kids get the cerebral nicknames. How many of y'all remember watching the N1 mixtape? What was it called on ESPN? What was it called? When they would go around the country playing basketball. What's the name of the show? What's the name of the show? Street Ball? Where all the guys had all the nicknames? Okay, it's Hot Sauce, Up North, similar to what I'm talking about. Hot Sauce, Up North, AO. What was the white point guard's name from Portland, the 17-year-old kid who was on the team? What was his nickname? Who said it? The Professor, right? See, you on it, man. See, you didn't know how to connect that before, did you, all right? So he's the youngest guy on the team of grown men, black men in their 30s and 40s. He's 17. But he has the nickname the Professor, like he's in charge of all of them, all right? So the next time you watch ESPN, understand that a lot of black kids, a lot of black boys especially, their aspirations in life are set from that one channel. And when you look at other TV shows and TV stations, we don't have that many positive images of black males on TV. And please don't bring up Empire, because that's nonsense, all right? So it's no wonder why even my son and other black kids in the suburbs who were part of well-educated families, right? If you ask them what they want to do, he said, well, Dad, I'm going to the NFL first. I'm like, come on, man. My son had he graduated from PK, from kindergarten. He had to come to the podium and say what he wanted to be. And I said, I know he's going to say President Obama. I was just waiting. He was like the only black kid up there anyway. And I said, that's my son right there. He gets up there and says, I want to play in the NBA. I'm like, come on, man. All right. But so we've just been trying to fight in many ways these images. And even as a professor, I get the stereotype, right? I remember I was teaching at LSU on one Friday. I didn't teach on Fridays. I was going to the library. I probably had on jeans and a t-shirt or something like that, or a shirt. And a white kid passed me. He said, good luck tomorrow. I'm like, damn, what's going on tomorrow? All right? Okay. And he thought I played on the football team, all right? And even now, my colleagues at Texas, and I love them, they're good people, they will ask you, Leonard, did you play? You played football in college, right? Tecmo Bowl on Nintendo, that was about it. But in many ways, it's these stereotypes we are still trying to get out of. And we love athletics, but some of us believe that it has just gone too far in many ways in the African-American community. So I hope this was fun. Hope we can have a little discussion. You know what I mean? And, you know, I'm just myself. But I like sports, but I have a love-hate relationship with it. So thank you. All right. Any questions at all? Yes, sir, in the back. I know what he's talking about. I said, thank you. I know what he's talking about. Thought he was talking about good luck, getting tenure or something like that, all right? He's talking about playing a game, all right? All right? All right? But it's funny now, so as a senior associate VP at Texas, I get season tickets every year, typically between the 30s somewhere. And I know the first game every year, I typically sit around longtime season ticket holders. So me and my wife, or me and my son, go to the game, the first game of the year. I look at my watch and I say, it'll be about within 2 minutes, I'm asked by the white person sitting next to me, your son play on the team? I said, I don't think so. All right. But I'm serious. But that's the expectation, that my son is out there, all right? They said, well, you got a cousin? No. I guess they all could be my cousins, but I don't know them, all right? All right, but it's good to laugh at, all right? Yeah.
I wonder if you could talk about what you think might come out of what happened in Missouri, possible implications.
I think black athletes now are beginning to realize the leverage that they have. You know, I think they're beginning to realize that they have power, that the university is using them for to make a ton of money. I mean, I don't know how many Johnny Manziel fans we have in here. I'm from Cleveland, so I like him now. But the one thing A&M did with Manziel, first of all, he took majority of online classes, and they said they had him on private jets often going to meet with boosters. And so if you look at that big renovation of Kyle Field, Johnny Manziel built all of that. You know what I mean? So I think now student athletes are beginning to realize that they have the power. I told some high school recruits, I said, why don't you all start evaluating the coaches instead of letting them all evaluate, you know, letting them evaluate you? Because we need a system where coaches can be evaluated, right? But the problem is, when you got black kids and they believe that athletics is not one of many ways out, but they believe it is the way out, these coaches in many ways play mind games on them. Coaches tell them that, well, you know, if you're trying to get over there, I'm sort of the vessel I'm the avenue to get that done. And so we just have to do a much better job of letting these student athletes realize how much power they have. I tell the people at Texas, 51,000 students, this past year we had about 42,000 applications, admitted about 14,000, half of those came, that the only students who didn't have to apply to UT were those high-profile athletes. You know, and that gives them a degree of power if they begin to recognize that, okay? Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
How? But why and how do you feel like they should be compensated for, you know, what they're doing for the university?
I believe, just as I believe that the professor in computer engineering who brings in a ton of grant money should get paid a whole lot more than the history professor who brings in nothing. All right, I'm a history professor, so I can say that, Rebecca. All right? All right? But it seems funny to me. I tell people, why do we think that it's correct that they shouldn't get paid? Just because a system is set up in such a way, it doesn't mean it's right. You know what I mean? I don't see it, but I think at every high-profile school, kids should get $100,000 a year. I think they should be paid market value. I don't think they should all be paid the same amount. Right? I mean, at Tennessee, the women's basketball team may get paid more than everybody else. Right? At UConn especially. Right? At LSU, the women on the track team may get paid more. I believe whatever you are worth, you should be able to get paid that amount. And I don't believe in one way that devalues the academic mission. Right? Yes.
What about non-revenue sports? Because football and basketball, especially the team, and baseball pay for all other sports.
We are revenue, right, we are revenue generating society. So when I was at LSU, I would tell all the non-revenue, this was mean to me, but I didn't care. I had to say it. I told them, I said, if you all are in line at the cafeteria or the training table, and football, men's, women's basketball come in to eat, you should get out of line and tell them thank you. Here's what happened. We got inner city black kids subsidizing scholarships for wealthy white kids in country club sports. Tennis, golf, right? Swimming, don't generate anything, right? But you got these poor black kids in there. The revenue that they generate subsidizes that wealthy, subsidize the education for those country club sports. And I just don't think that's right. Yes?
With athletes realizing that, like the way you said, that they realize they have more power and being able to, just bargain, do you think that they will utilize it more for academic advancement or no?
I think you would hope, but I don't think so. I think for too many high-profile athletes, the academic light doesn't come on till the dream is over. You know what I mean? Till the dream is over. But that would be awesome if they began to say, okay, no, you aren't going to control. You're not going to allow a coach to make academic decisions, all right? And too often in many places, that's what's happening, all right? Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Let me use AAU basketball as an example. Let's say I got a 9-year-old kid from inner city Dallas, all right? Can play basketball. His basketball talent has probably took him out of town for the first time, put him on an airplane for the first time, stayed in a nice hotel for the first time. So when this kid is 16, right? Every opportunity in his mind has come as a result of basketball, right? And so when they get to college, they don't realize it's about to stop. You know what I mean? So, you know, I think William Roden in his book, The $40 Million Slave, talks about this athletic industrial complex that identifies this black young talent early on and puts him on this conveyor belt, you know, with the goal of being the NFL and NBA. But I tell young men, the NBA and NFL, this is one of the only professions where you got to be the best of the best to get a job, right? Any other profession, you can be mediocre, average, but in those professions, you got to be the best of the best. And unfortunately, the dream doesn't hit a lot of young men till it's too late. I have former students at LSU, 28, 29 years old, who were playing in adult flag football leagues, hoping that a scout would come see them. All right? Former student at Texas, he played, his last year playing at Texas was 1992. He was in my class, and I could tell he was still struggling. He would always want to come to my office and show me YouTube videos of him playing like in 1991 season. I'm like, dude, it's over, all right? But they don't know how to transition out of the role because it was a big part of their formative identity, all right? Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
I have a question about the NCAA. Mm-hmm. Where do you think they fit into all of this?
I think it's a cartel. All right? I mean, what other entity were, do you have people who provide the labor don't get any compensation? Slavery, okay. And I tell my athletic director friends, they say, well, Dr. Moore, man, that scholarship costs us $40,000 a year. I said, but it's not real money. The only material cost for a student athlete is primarily food. The buildings are already up. It doesn't cost the professor any amount of, it doesn't cost the university any more money to teach four of the kids in a classroom. And so they say, well, the scholarship is worth this. I say, well, no, not really. All right, but it's a cartel. So my hope is one day before the NCAA, the Final Four, the two games on Saturday, is that the guys on the team, those four teams, will say, we're not playing until we get $1 million each. And guess what will happen before that game starts? Y'all remember the World Cup? What team did that in the World Cup? They didn't get paid. Was that Ghana? Y'all don't remember? I think it was Ghana. We were in Cape Town last summer. I think the Ghana team said they weren't playing unless they got paid, because they hadn't got paid like 2 months. And they said, next thing you know, they were delivering some money to them, all right? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So I hear two separate threads. Right? Uh-huh. One is that under our current system, which exploits athletes, uh-huh, you sort of hope to see athletes fight that power, mm-hmm, and gain power within that system. Mm-hmm. But then on the other hand, you want me as a professor to challenge that system and, mm-hmm, make sure that I'm working against that. Am I catching that right?
Let me hear it again. Right. Mm-hmm.
So how do those two things square up? Because we sort of have two.
Give me the first one again.
The prevailing system that exists.
Right.
Athletes.
Right. Okay.
And so you want to see athletes rise to the maximum that they can within that system, mm-hmm, which would be to get paid. Mm-hmm. But doesn't that reinforce their identity as being only athletes?
I don't think so. Let me give you an example. Anybody here play an instrument? Anybody here good? All right, anybody good? All right? No, the point I always give, if I'm in the College of Fine Arts, okay, and I play the trumpet or saxophone, or I'm a great actress or something like that, let's say I'm in Austin, right? I can go to Nordstrom's during the Christmas season and play the piano, right? And if I'm good, Nordstrom's will pay me whatever it costs, right? Anytime a concert comes, they may hire me to play. Student athletes are not allowed to use their talent off campus at all to make money, right? And I don't think that, you know, them getting a paycheck diminishes the intellectual side at all, right? The problem is most university presidents don't want to deal with the system that they've created. And when I was at LSU, I had a couple young men in my class who couldn't read. So me and the provost went to lunch. I said, here are the exams. You're the chief academic officer. An agent of this university recruit that young man to come to school here. How do I evaluate this as a professor? Because we brought the kid here. You know what the provost said? He said, I don't know. And most university presidents will tell you the quickest way to get fired is not academics. It's typically athletics or some sort of other issue. Presidents don't even control the athletic department. That's how, in many ways, out of control things are. Okay, I hope that answered your question. Okay. Yes.
You spoke a lot about young black men. Uh-huh. What are some of the similarities or differences for young black female athletes, mm-hmm, in college?
I think the biggest thing, there was a female coach in the SEC. She told the women on her basketball team, if you aren't a lesbian, I'm putting you on birth control. All right? Now, could you imagine a man telling a female student that? He would be fired the next day. The biggest question I have for women coaches and women athletic directors is that if I'm a female athlete and I'm on scholarship and I get pregnant, what happens to my scholarship? It's gone. Now, if that's not a violation of Title IX, if that's not gender discrimination, but what we've seen is that a lot of athletic departments, they want to hire. Let me back up. A lot of athletic departments, they want to hire coaches who are single with no kids. And so sometimes coaches who are married and have families, they will tell you, it is hard for me to get a head coaching job. Because the program, the athletic director wants them to be all in and have no other interests outside of the sport. So I think, when you hear some of these stories about these white girls playing soccer and tennis, and just all the harassment and the verbal abuse, some women are still scarred from a lot of that. You know, being called ugly. One of my TAs right now, she played tennis at a school up in the, I think it's the All-American Conference now. And she just talked about how the culture just cussed them out, called them fat, was calling them the B word and all that kind of stuff. And they're 18, 19, 20 years old. You know, threatening to take their scholarship if they were dating the wrong person, just all that kind of stuff. So that's what I tell my feminist friends we need to look into. Because there's a lot of under the radar harassment in women's sports. Mm-hmm. All right. Yes. It's tough. It's tough. Some student athletes will tell you that, you know, the parent or parents may make them feel guilty. Well, we did all this for you. You know what I mean? That kind of stuff. My challenge has always been letting them know they could, there are other ways they can make money other than playing professional sports. And that's why, you know, we've launched these study abroad programs in Cape Town in China. But I'll be honest, and I'm not saying a thing I haven't said at Texas. It's been hard to get student-athletes to go on those trips. Because I think coaches, they appeal to the student-athletes' desire to be competitive. You know what I mean? They'll say, yeah, well, you can go to South Africa with Dr. Moore, but that's 5 weeks you're not training. And don't you want to go to the Olympics? Don't you want to be All-American? You see what I mean? And I think there's this culture now of overtraining. And I think that's why you're seeing a lot more energies, because kids never get any time off. Any D3, any TLU athletes in here? Anybody? Okay. All right. How do y'all feel? How do you feel? Yeah. Yeah, I put you on the spot, but I don't care, man. All right. I don't care. Uh-huh.
I agree with what you're saying. With some people are taught this is what you have to do to make it. I definitely believe that's a strong mindset in a lot of individuals.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's purposely done, but like what you deal with is, I guess, a form of abuse. Mm-hmm.
Most coaches don't know any better, but I'm gonna tell you what's gonna happen soon. A coach is gonna get killed. I'm here. I believe it. At some point, a coach is gonna do the wrong thing to the wrong person. What'd you say? Oh yeah. I remember. I don't know why we don't take that seriously. And no other work environment is that acceptable. But for whatever reason, when it comes to sports, we think that's the way we motivate people and get them to do better. You know, I told the coach, talk to people like they're adults. You know what I mean? But I predict it'll happen at some point. All right. Yes. No. I mean, you look at what the NFL has done with the concussion stuff. And I bet you'll start to see a lot of lawsuits with student athletes filing lawsuits against the universities for concussion symptoms, right? But we just have to do a better job of training coaches. I mean, some of these coaches, I went to Ohio State, you know, but I wasn't particularly happy when they won a national championship. I was at the game in Dallas. I wanted Oregon to win. Because I know some of the stuff that goes on behind the scenes and it's not right.
They didn't happen in Oregon too, though?
Yeah, but I don't know about it, Oregon. Right? Okay, right. Right? Yeah.
Where do you think that mentality comes from? I gotta make it, I gotta go pro.
ESPN. Where else can you see black men, tattoos, earrings, locks, whatever, being themselves and being supported, being applauded, and being. You know what I mean? Just, what'd you say? What's the word you use? Right, Iverson, right? I mean, that's the only place you see it. So one guy told me, he said, Doc, the NBA man is the only place a black man could be a man. All right. Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
Have you had a chance to hear before parents?
Yes. You know what the difficult part of that is? I mean, I help UT with a lot of recruiting, particularly on the football end, basketball end. Because I really believe what Shaka Smart and Charlie Strong. Let me say this about Charlie Strong, all right? And I told some alums this. I said, we can build a 14-0 program if that's what y'all want. But I'd rather be 8-4 with integrity than 14-0, right, with no integrity, all right? And if they give Coach Strong some time, when I look at the football team now, any other coach would have kicked off 15 more guys from the team, because most coaches, if you're not producing your sophomore year, guess what? You are encouraged to transfer. And by encouraged, I mean you may be watching on ESPN. You'd be like, man, I'm going to UTSA next year? All right? They'll handle it for you, all right? But what I like about Coach Strong and Shaka Smart, I mean, Shaka Smart, I met with two recruits in basketball. One young man, ACT at 31, the other ACT at 30. And we lost out on one young man, he went to Duke, all right? But, you know, when Mike Krzyzewski walks in the room, it's over pretty much, all right? What was your question again? Parents. Most parents, and it's sad on a recruiting visit, because what I try to tell parents is that this is a business relationship. You got to understand that. It is a business relationship, right? They're recruiting your son or daughter, not because they like them, but because they can help them win ball games. All right? But it's unfortunate because parents are caught up in the hype, just like a lot of the kids are. And that's what we have to begin to change, this idea. But sometimes parents are more difficult to get across to than the kids. All right? Yeah.
As a parent yourself, how do you mentor kids coming from? Because I know from high school, I lived behind the hype in basketball, people applauding and all. And I didn't know how to move on from that with high school ended. So how do you teach it, tell your kids how to move on from?
From sports? And my daughter is a very good basketball player. She's eighth grade, super good. But, and this may not be fair to her, I'm not gonna allow her to become a part of that AU stuff. You know what I mean? And I like my daughter. She said, Daddy, I really like playing for my school. I don't really like doing the tournaments and stuff. And somebody said, well, if she don't play in those tournaments, scouts won't see her. Well, thankfully, we don't need an athletic scholarship for her to go to college. You know what I mean? And so we have that kind of freedom. But just, I think parents have to be more deliberate in saying, well, no, we're not doing all that. You know, I'm not driving somewhere three nights a week just so she can practice basketball. All right? Okay. Yes?
Okay, so my brother, he's 14. He's a freshman in high school. And he's very fast. He's very good at basketball. Mm-hmm. And he's good at football. So, he's all around, super good athlete. Mm-hmm.
Is he playing against black kids? That was a joke. Okay. That was a joke. Go ahead. Because fast is relative, right? I told my daughter, I said, now, Jocelyn, you good for Austin Round Rock, but we ain't been to inner city Houston yet. All right, different level down there. Right, look at y'all, H, all right? Okay, all right, go ahead. Okay.
Okay, so he wants to play for AAU and all that. But mom's like, no, school is more important. Mm-hmm. Like, if you're going to get noticed, they're going to notice you at school.
I agree. I think you got to balance it. And I don't think all AAU or him running track is bad. I think who the coach is determines. I just got a rule. My daughter's not going to play on an AAU team if the coach at the AAU team doesn't have a real job. Right, that is their real job. Right. So I'm not being a part of that. You know what I mean? I want her to play for somebody who has a career, who's not looking at this as a way for them to make money. Because we've seen that get abused. Friend of mine, his son played on the AAU team. They were traveling all across the country. And his son wasn't even getting in the games. I said, man, you mean to tell me y'all flew to Las Vegas and your son didn't even play? So that's what I mean, sometimes the parents being caught up in it. I think my friend got excited about the idea of his telling his people, well, my son plays on Texas Elite or whatever the name of the team was. Okay, all right. Anybody else? Yeah.
So you talked about, is there a way for athletes to get paid within the NCAA, because I don't believe so. I think the only way for athletes to get paid would be for the Power Five conferences to come together and just say bump NCAA, which would end up hurting D2 and the other D1 athletes and the D3 athletes.
How will it hurt the other athletes?
Because I think without the Power Five, the NCAA will crumble.
Yeah, it will.
And so,
but I would say not even the Power Five. I have a theory that the top 30 athletic programs are just going to pull out and do their own deal.
But what's that mean? Top 30 in football or top 30 in basketball, football or what?
Football is the money maker.
Yeah,
I mean, the Final Four is what makes money in college basketball, the tournament, but football is the money maker, right? That's why, although Kansas has a great athletic basketball program, they'll make money in football, you know, okay? So I think that'll happen at some point.
Possible, because I think it's the next 10, 15 years. Soon.
Could you imagine if the top 30 football programs pulled out, that TV contract would be arguably just as expensive as the NFL contract? It makes no sense for Texas to play Iowa State and those. So imagine if Texas was playing USC one week, Michigan the next, Alabama the next. You have a full playoff system. What do you say?
They wouldn't want that.
Texas wouldn't want that?
Nobody would want that.
Why?
Because you're more susceptible to losses, and that's less money. Because all the coaches get the bonuses per win, and per conference championship. So if you're playing like Texas plays USC, I think next year.
Yeah, I know you're thinking deep. I don't think they're thinking that deep, all right?
I mean, so Alabama's playing LSU, then they're playing Texas, and they're playing our traditional USC.
But the whole system would change because now it's about you can't lose the game because you want to go to the playoff, but then it wouldn't matter. I mean, like, I'm a Cleveland Browns fan. They say before the NFL season starts, all the NFL owners have made their money. Them winning games doesn't really add to the revenue stream because they've gotten all their money from TV contracts. So we'll see what happens, okay? All right. If nothing else, thank you all so much. Thank you all for spending your Monday afternoon here. All right? Thank you.
Students at TLU engage in high-impact educational experiences that include civic engagement, aesthetic expression, critical thinking, and a focus on intercultural knowledge in a community that welcomes the interplay of faith and reason.